Dog is Family on BCTV is supported by Godfrey's. Welcome to Dogdom.
Hello, and thank you for joining us for our show tonight, Dog is Family. We're certainly in the middle of winter, and it's a very cold evening, so we hope that you'll sit back and enjoy some of the topics we have tonight. My name is Barb Emmett. I am the producer and host of this show for the next half hour, so please stay with us. I am a certified dog lover, a dog mom to two golden retrievers, and the proprietor of Godfrey's Welcome to Dogdom. The purpose of our show is to bring all kinds of wonderful topics to you to enhance your life with your dogs, because they are, after all, family. So I'd like to introduce the guests we have on the show tonight. To my right is Megan Christel. Hi, Megan.
Hi.
Thanks for joining us tonight.
Thanks for having me, Barb.
She's going to be talking about a really interesting experience that she had that is very fulfilling and a way to inspire you, we hope, for those who love dogs and love animals and would love to learn more about what they can do with them. And to Megan's right, we have Denise Lacey.
Hi, Barb.
Hi, Denise. She's our certified professional dog trainer who comes on our program and shares very interesting topics about dog training, dog tips, all with positive reinforcement. So thanks again for joining us. We're going to get into these topics right away. Please get a paper and pencil together, because I think we have some things for you that you may want to jot down to refer to later. So on that note, we're going to get started right away. Again, the first guest will be Megan. And I'd like to give you a brief bio about Megan so that you know a little bit more about her background and where she's coming from and her experiences. She is a senior at Penn State, and she'll be graduating in May with a Communication Arts and Sciences major, a psychology minor, and a civic engagement minor. She works part-time at Godfrey's Welcome to Dogdom as a sales associate, where she states she is able to fulfill her passion for helping dogs. Megan has a dog of her own, as we all do, and her name is Lola. Lola is a 5-year-old yellow lab, and as Megan states, she is my heart and soul, which speaks to all of us here who love dogs as family. And Megan's dream is to one day start her own business that can positively impact the lives of animals. So we hope that this can be an inspiration to you. So Megan, let's start. Okay. How have dogs changed your life? And when did you know that you had such a special love for dogs?
I would say I knew, or the people around me knew, even before I knew.
Interesting.
My mom likes to tell stories. When I was a kid, a toddler, I would walk up to any dog on the street or go and greet anyone I could with a dog, which kind of scared her at times.
Certainly.
But
certainly.
So I think I've always had a natural passion and love for dogs. I've always been drawn to them. So that's something that has definitely stayed with me throughout my entire life.
Very, very good that you've recognized that passion. Do we have a picture? We didn't bring Lola in tonight.
No, we
did not. Although it would
have
been nice to meet Lola. I believe we brought a picture in of Megan's dog, Lola, if we could show that photo of the yellow lab, so that you can at least see her in her happy face. How old is Megan? How old is she, Megan?
Lola is 5 years old. She just turned 5 in December, so.
Aww. Well, she's a very
special. She still acts like she's 6 months old, though. So.
Well, she looks very happy there.
Yeah, she is. She's a good girl.
Thank you for showing us that.
Sure.
Meg, was there any volunteer work you had done with dogs or with animals before this experience that we're going to talk about at Best Friends Animal Sanctuary?
Before Best Friends, I've spent many years walking dogs at the local shelters. And I've also been fortunate enough to have my own dog sitting business. So I do. I spend some of my free time doing that, so I enjoy that very much.
That's great. Then this year, something very exciting happened. Megan took a 5-week internship to Best Friends Animal Sanctuary in Kanab, Utah, quite a distance for someone to travel to do an internship.
Yes.
Right? tell us a little bit more about Best Friends Animal Sanctuary, if you can.
Sure. Yeah, Best Friends is the largest no-kill animal shelter in the United States. They're the leader in all of the movements and initiatives in their no-kill mission. Their largest slogan is Save Them All, and they definitely do their best to abide by that mission. So going out there, to say the least, was a life-changing experience, and I got to meet so many passionate and amazing people, and really get to know a lot of the animals out there, and it was an awesome experience.
It certainly is a beautiful area of the country. I know myself and my husband have visited there just for a brief time and have always been impressed with their mission and their commitment to save them all. As obviously we all would love to have happen that all animals that need new homes are saved rather than euthanized. So that's just one of the programs that is very different out there. Right, Meg?
Yes, absolutely.
How did your internship come about? Like, what happened to you that you found out about it and felt that you wanted to make that commitment?
I found out about Best Friends actually through you and Pat at Godfrey's. That's how it came about. And then once I learned about it, I decided to do some research to see what it was all about, and I was in love from the moment I was on their website. So I was able to look into some of their employment opportunities and internship opportunities, and I was pleased to find that they had a 5-week internship. So I boldly took the chance to apply for that, and I was lucky enough to get in, and with the help of many, many people, I was able to go out there and do it. So
it's excellent. It sounds like it all fit too with what you're going to school for, with civic engagement.
Yes, absolutely.
So it's a really good fit. Mm-hmm. And wanting to make a difference, to talk about the nonprofit world of making a difference for animals. Well, show us, she's brought some wonderful slides for us to see, and I think Megan has some little stories behind each of those. Think about a 5-week commitment out there, and she's gonna run us through some of that and show us some of the sites. Mm-hmm. So why don't we go ahead and show some of those. What are we looking at there, Meg?
That is actually, as you're driving into Best Friends, into the canyon where the sanctuary is located, that is their sign that's located by the main road. So I had to stop and take a picture, of course. Mm-hmm. Okay, so like Barb was saying, it was a 5-week internship, a general animal care internship. So each week that we were out there, we rotated Monday through Friday to different animal areas. And out at Best Friends, they have cats, dogs, pigs, horses, and a wildlife rehabilitation center. So I did all of those except for the wildlife. So like the slide shows, I spent my first week in bunnies. And having not much experience in bunnies, I didn't know what to expect, but I met a lot of really nice people who showed me a lot of what to do and how to care for them, and I learned so much. Bunnies are really great pets to have. In addition to cats or dogs or more normal pets. So that was a really cool experience to get to know more about the little furry creatures.
And they do very well with adopting them out, Meg?
Yes, they do. It's hard to keep them there.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Okay, and then my second week in pigs, which was surprisingly my favorite so week there. Very similar to dogs, pigs have very distinct personalities and they're very intelligent. And I didn't know what to expect, again, having never worked with pigs, but by the end of the week I knew, I think while I was there they had about 25 pigs total. And definitely by the end of the week I got to know each and every one of them and I knew what they liked and didn't like. And
wow.
They do this hilarious thing called the running of the pigs for feeding time. So they put all the pigs at the end of one pen and lock it up, and we put out all their food at the other side, and then they unlock the gate and let them run free, and it's absolutely hysterical.
So very distinct personalities.
Yes, yes, and, very cool.
Very cool.
And then my third week was in cats. Out at Best Friends, they have a lot of different areas for different kinds of animals. So I was stationed in cat headquarters, which is where they keep the cats who have more like behavioral issues or need a little extra training or neurological stuff, so they have them close to the vet clinics. But they have other areas for feline leukemia or cats who are older, and they have very specialized areas for these cats. So being in cat headquarters, I got to meet, again, a lot of interesting personalities. And I got to walk some cats. I got to push cats in strollers, which is something I've never done before, which was a very interesting experience. But yeah, so that was my week in cats, pretty much. And then my fourth week I spent in horses, and prior to going out to Best Friends, I had a large fear of horses. Just because they're such big creatures and I don't really know how to read them like I would a dog. I just didn't know how to feel about them. But after my week out there and spending a lot of time with the trainers and things like that, I really got to know more about their body language and how to approach them and what they like or don't like. So I can honestly say now, after being back, I have a love for horses and I appreciate them very much. They're beautiful creatures.
Did you watch them being trained at any point? Any kind of the training methods that they use?
Yes.
Yes. You got to observe that.
Mm-hmm. Out at Best Friends, they practice the Pirelli method, which is a natural horsemanship program. It's not anything, it's not negative, it's all positive, it's very humane, and it's amazing how quickly and easily the horses respond to the training, which is just used with a stick with a string attached to it, more or less, and that's more than enough for the horses to follow because they're such sensitive beings. So
you got to work and with a goat.
There's a goat
too.
What's
yeah
that?
I was just gonna say the same thing. She got to work with a goat too.
She got to work with a goat. I know. Goats.
Yes.
Next, adorable. What about the goats?
Next to the horses, they keep the goats, and they had two sheep while I was there also. And the goats are absolutely hysterical. Like, they just jump on top of things. They actually, there was a trainer out there who was doing agility with goats, so that was really cool to see. But yeah, I just found myself cracking up at all their personalities and the things that they would do. So very cool. And then my fifth and final week out there was finally with dogs, the best for last.
Yeah.
Like I said, with cats, they have many different areas for dogs as they do for cats. They call them octagons. The octagon that I was in for the week was called Maggie's Mercantile, and that was where they do most of the training for the dogs. So again, those dogs had behavioral problems or came from tough situations or were shy or neurological problems. So they needed a little extra TLC. But all of the dogs out there were, I mean, you gave them a moment to come up to you or to warm up to you, and they just wanted to be loved. They were the happiest dogs on the planet. So in my week in dogs, I spent a lot of time walking and feeding and doing things that I'm used to doing, so it was comforting being
probably
out there.
Probably felt good then to be back with the first love, which was your dog.
Yes,
to
it
be
did.
Coming back to them.
Yes, it did.
Do you know those two? Do you remember them?
Yes, the dog on the left, the white dog with the gray spot over his eye, that's Wally.
Oh.
He was like the biggest pit bull I've ever seen, but he was such a love. And the dog on the right, her name was Jody. She's a golden retriever lab and shepherd mix, I believe, and she was also very, very sweet. So.
Well, you have some information up here. Go ahead, tell us a little bit more about your blog.
Sure.
And that information.
Yeah, so I have the link to Best Friends website. That's the first link up top, just for you guys to go out and check the website yourself to find out more information of how you can get involved and what they're all about, and lots of great resources on there to check out. And then the bottom link is my blog that I did while I was out there. I tried to write every single day while I was out there about my experiences. So that's like a day-to-day account for what I did while I was out there. So that was fun to do, and it's fun to look back on now that I've been home for a while. So
you had many people following you. I know we all were, and
yes,
the numbers just kept jumping up as far as how many people were watching and they couldn't reading and they couldn't wait to see the next blog.
Yeah.
And Megan had a great way of writing that you just couldn't wait to read the next day's blog.
Oh, so thank you.
Am I right that says Megan's Dream Internship?
Yes, yes. You are
okay.
Correct.
.blogspot.com.
Yep, that's how she felt. So. I know when you were there as well that there were some, not only were you working in the different animal areas, but they did expose you to some of the key people who either founded this organization,
yes,
or very influential and knowledgeable about some issues. Tell us about a few of those people.
Sure. We were also fortunate enough to experience a lot of the founders of Best Friends. They talked at, we were at the lunch cafe, which is called the Village Cafe, and we ate there almost every day. And the founders would stand up and talk in front of everyone, and they were very down to earth. And so that was really neat to be so in such close contact with the founders. They were very involved with everything that we were doing. So That was really nice.
Very impactful.
Mm-hmm.
And then Dr. Frank McMillan, I noted, he did a presentation on puppy mills.
Yes. Dr. Frank McMillan is actually from Pennsylvania. He works with a lot of students at the University of Penn, and he's conducted a lot of studies on puppy mills and comparing a puppy mill dog to an adult breeder dog and how their quality of life has been impacted. And so we got lots of presentations from him on training and puppy mills. And
excellent.
Yeah, so it was really, really cool to hear from him.
And the last one, emergency response team, having a disaster plan. I bet that was very interesting. Dogs,
yes,
that they had gone, best friends had gone into New Orleans and
mm-hmm.
even Sandy Hook, I believe.
Yes.
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 So she certainly got exposed to a lot of wonderful, interesting things. It's interesting to me how a place out on 3,000 acres or so many acres can mm-hmm. adopt and have such a successful adoption rate.
Right.
Just one quick statement about how they do that, Meg.
I think the biggest thing for Best Friends is they're really expanding into the surrounding environments, and they have a lot of network partners all over the country that they're able to host super adoptions and host events where they can get recognition, like Strut Your Mutt is one of their big ones that they host every year. So they're all over the country. It's not just in Kanab, Utah. But just like you said, even though they're very secluded, they still have a fair share of people visiting and adopting constantly throughout the year. So they still make it work.
They make it work, and we will save them all, which is a wonderful motto. So
yes,
thanks, Meg, for all this. We're very excited.
Oh, you're very welcome.
And
Thank
we
you.
Know that when you've come back now that you'll turn that passion and that interest into something else for our county or somewhere wherever you end up. Right?
Absolutely. That's my dream.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Well, that leads to the next topic of presentation, which is Denise. She's going to talk about, okay, so we've had successful adoption. We've had successful rescue and adoption. What do we do? Many of you have taken home new dogs over the holidays. What are some things we should be talking about, Denise, with adding a rescue dog to the family?
Yeah, well, you know, the interesting thing, Barb, is a lot of the things that we're going to talk about with adding a rescue dog are going to apply, whether it's a rescue dog or a new dog puppy from a breeder, and it's going to apply regardless of the age of your rescue dog. A couple of slides here, as we always go to, for you guys to take a look at. Regardless of whether it's puppies, adolescents, or older dogs, a lot of the things are all going to be the same for them. One of the first things you want to do is before you add that member to the family, because as we've talked about, it is adding a member to the family. You're
Absolutely.
Making a commitment for the hopefully life of that animal, which with a dog could be anywhere, depending on the size and breed of the dog, from 8 to 15 or more years. And you want to consider whether or not you have the time and money to care for a dog, your living environment. Does your realistic lifestyle match the type of dog that you're looking at adding to the family? A lot of us think, oh, it would be so much fun to have that energetic border collie and go for runs and play frisbee. But in reality, if you're much happier sitting working on the computer in the evenings when you get home from work, that border collie is just going to drive you crazy because they need to be out having a job, and they're not going to have one if you're not giving them time to do it. So when you bring that new dog home, routines and schedules can be really important. That helps with house training. And a lot of people think of house training as being something that's tied more to puppies, but that can be something that you're dealing with an older dog as well. If you've got an adolescent 9, 10, 11-month-old dog, depending on what their living situation is, they may have lost some of those house training skills, or you may be rescuing or adopting a dog that spent a lot of time living outside in a kennel or a run, and now you're bringing in into your home, and they don't know there are places we go and places we don't go. So you may find that you need to get on that schedule for house training, regardless of the age of the dog, to help them be successful in learning where you want them to relieve themselves. For meals and play, it's helpful for them to have a routine that they get into, to be able to predict what's coming next, know what's coming. That predictability leads to comfort for them and helps them develop trust in a new situation. And again, it may be a puppy that you're building a relationship with for the first time, or it may be a rescue dog where you're trying to heal a past bad negative relationship with people, and now you're trying to get them to understand that all people will not put them into that situation. So you want to try and be predictable. You want to try and set them up for a situation where they know what's going on. Lots of times, observing the dog and letting them lead can help with that. I know many people have that picture of the dog that's going to curl up them with them by on the sofa and be petted and loved on and is going to come and lick their face. But that's not true of every dog, just like it's not true of every person. So we want to make sure that we kind of read the dog. And if we go in and we scratch their ears and we stop and they back away, they're telling us they're not comfortable. So we want to keep that in mind as well. And then if you have other canines already in the family, we want to keep in mind the interactions between them when we bring them in. The dog language is a really complex language, and you need to be prepared for your already in the home dogs to give the cold shoulder to your new addition. They may not immediately be buddy-buddy playing all the time, which can be really disappointing if you brought that new family member in to be a companion for the dog that you already have in the home, or to replace a dog in a situation where you had dogs that really got along well, and maybe one has passed away, and now you're bringing in a new one. So keep in mind that there may be a transition period there. The older dog, or the dog that's already in the house, can say no. If it's a puppy coming in, they may have inappropriate play styles. And again, that can happen with an older dog that's a rescue dog too. They may not have been in a situation to learn appropriate play styles. Growling between dogs to say, hey, I'm not comfortable with what you're doing is very normal. Snapping is very normal too. What's not normal is having a dog injure another dog. So you need to be proactive, and that means that you're going to be supervising. When you have that new dog coming in, you want to keep an eye on the dogs that are together. If your puppy is climbing all over your older dog and your older dog is growling, we don't want to be correcting the older dog. We want to be redirecting the puppy, because the older dog is being very appropriate in saying, hey, that is not how we behave, and that's correct. You don't, as a grown-up dog, climb all over the head of another dog. And again, it may not be a puppy. It may be that 10, 12-month-old adolescent who hasn't had a chance to learn to play appropriately. Create safe spaces, gates between rooms, crates, X-pens. Safe spaces not just for your new addition, but for your older dog too, because they may need to get away. Help your dog learn the new rules of the home by rewarding what you like. Teach behaviors that the dog might not know, and we could go on for ages that. Use the dog's strengths. If you've got a dog that likes to be active, throwing the frisbee, throwing the ball. If you've got one that likes to be a couch potato, let them curl up with you. And of course, we briefly touched on canine family members, but if you've got other species in the house or kids, that's a whole nother ball of wax when you're doing those introductions. So hopefully that gives you a little bit to think about if you're looking at adding a new member of the family, whether it be a rescue dog or a dog from any other situation.
That's excellent. Thank you, Denise. You always bring out points that people may or may not have thought about. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I agree.
Excellent.
You're welcome.
Mm-hmm. Hope you jotted those notes down. On a last really brief expose, it's the new year. So we want to think about healthy treats, healthy foods for the dogs, their stomach health, their fitness health, their paw health in these snowy, icy days, and just a few items to think about. Weight loss, one of the wonderful new products that's out on the market is Fruitables, which is a very well thought out, scientifically based product with inulin in it, with pumpkin fiber to help supplement their regular diet in a very healthy way, rather than looking at some foods that are not so healthy and just adding some bulk without real satisfying nutrients. This is something. There are some wonderful beef stews out there that are very soon going to have the mark on them, human grade and FDA approved. Fabulous mixture of products that you just can't beat if you have a fussy dog, an older dog that's not ready to eat in the new year, and replacing some of the less effective and well-known foods with better products and better quality. Stomach, many times as they're getting older, they need some stomach health, as we all do. There are products like this that encourage the pre and probiotics in the stomach to produce better, so for better digestion. Be aware when your dog is having some problems, if you're switching foods or if they've been on an antibiotic, that they do need important health kicks to get them going. Another one would be something that mixes enzymes as well. This is a natural herbal supplement. So be aware, you may not have to do this at all times throughout, but perhaps in times where they've been sick or been on antibiotics, and it's winter and sometimes the immune system does falter. Some other things, this one product called Musher Secrets, which is a fabulous product for the paw pads this time of year. A waxy product that can go between their paws. It's all natural. between their paws so that the snow does not collect, and they can lick this. This is not toxic, and it's a wonderful product for protection, where some dogs don't want to wear things like paws, the balloon paw protectors on those icy streets, or the boots. Just something like this can be very effective. And on that note, we're going to give it up. We just want you to be thinking a little bit more about their joints, their health, and wellness for this 2015.
And
thanks again
year.
For joining us, and Happy New Year. Let's all say Happy New Year to you. Thanks again, and you can show our slide for the ending of the show. If you have ideas, please forward your questions, ideas for topics to us, and we'll look at doing them in the future. See you on the second Thursday of the month in February at 7 p.m. Bye-bye.
Dog is Family on BCTV is supported by Godfrey's. Welcome to Dogdom.